With interest rates higher than they've been in over 20 years, many analysts and economists have expected the economy and then the financial markets to buckle under the higher cost of debt. After all, we have six times the total public debt as we did the last time interest rates were this high. But whether that will eventually prove true, the markets are priced as if it won't. Right now, they're priced for no recession, no adverse lag effects from the historically aggressive hiking and tightening campaign pursued over the past year and a half by the Federal Reserve and most of the other major world central banks. So, when will this higher cost of debt matter? Will it matter? For answers, we turn to the highly popular and always informed money manager and macro analyst, Michael Pento. Michael, my friend, thank you so much for joining us today.
Hey, you know, it's always a pleasure to be on with you, Adam.
Mutual association, brother. You're one of my absolute favorite people to interview, and you are definitely, without a doubt, one of the most requested guests by the Wealth Hand audience. So know that you're here among friends, Michael. So lots to talk about with you. If we can, let's just start with the general question I like to ask you at the start of all our discussions. What's your current assessment of the global economy and financial markets?
Well, I think it's very clear to me through the facts that I look at every day that the recession has been delayed. It's been held in abeyance, but it's absolutely not been canceled. The soft landing narrative is a complete myth. And let's just go through some of the reasons why I believe the recession was delayed, some of the most popular ones, and then I'll get to the real one, or the most salient reason why I think the recession is delayed. 2023, we had massive deficit spending. Now, a lot of people just end the conversation with, well, you know, you can deficit spend and that's stimulative to the economy. Well, we had massive deficits in 2000, 2001, 2002, 2008. Massive deficits caused by the automatic stabilizers kicking in when you have a recession. So that's not really what I would call stimulative. And please don't forget that these massive deficits cannot continue forever to the pace and quantity that we are now experiencing, both in nominal terms and as a percentage of GDP. Because what happens when you run massive deficits, Adam? You destroy your economy. You get higher taxes, higher interest rates, higher inflation, and you destroy productivity. So let's just put that one aside. So that's one reason why it's delayed, but that can't continue. And in the long run, it really stinks. Okay, number two, consumers and businesses locked up a tremendous amount of low interest rates, a tremendous amount of debt at a tremendous amount of low interest rates. That is true, but there's a day of reckoning coming in 2024 and 2025, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. Of course, we also hear that the consumer has a lot of excess savings. Well, that was true in 2022, just as true as it was in 2023. So what do I think is the real reason why? I think the last time you had me on was around the time on Wealthy On. I think it was around the late spring when I was on, when we had these four banks fail. And I had predicted in 2022 that it was going to be in 2021, that 22 would be a bad year, and that 2023 we would have a recession. So why didn't it happen? I think if you want to put the nucleus out there and split that atom, it's because, no pun intended, by the way, is because we had the Bank Term Funding Program, which was a bailout of the entire U.S. financial system. That is what turned the market around. Remember, the economy and the market were turning into a ditch, going off the rails in March. Stock markets started to plunge. You had spreads widen out. High yield was blowing out. Financial conditions were tightening. And then the Fed came in and monetized. And this is key. They printed $400 billion of base money supply. What is the base money supply? It's high-powered money. It's called that for a reason. Because it's physical cash and Fed credit, which can be used to buy bonds and make loans and can in itself be turned into cash. They printed $400 billion in two freaking weeks, Adam, and that was 50% of the entire Fed's balance sheet from 1913 all the way through the end of 2008. That is why we have a recession delayed. And I want to spend, if I had my druthers, it's your show, I want to talk about all of the reasons why the recession is still coming. It has not been canceled. It's just being held in abeyance, but not for much longer.
All right. You've got a blindingly green light to do exactly just that, my friend. And we can jump right in there if you want to. You know, I talked at the beginning about the high cost of debt that we have right now. So we have a lot more debt right now, right? You just mentioned, you know, this $400 billion that was pumped out in 2 weeks via the BFTP. I think people kind of forget now, you know, with the Fed balance sheet up at, I don't know what it is right now, what, around 8 trillion or so?
It's a little over 8 trillion, I think it's 8.3 trillion right now.
Yeah, so 8.3 trillion. So that was only 800 billion at the start of a global financial crisis in 2008, right? I mean, it has gone up more than 10 times in, you know, what is that, right? Like 15 years or so. And that's just, it's mind-boggling to those of us who think of it. But I think to the average, you know, casual observer, that's sort of, whatever, you know, half a trillion, not even half a trillion. How could it be that bad? Well, I mean, that, as you said, was half the Fed's balance sheet just 15 years ago. Yeah. And so, as I said, I think the last time interest rates were in this territory, it was right at the turn of the millennium, right, where we had 1/6 the amount of public debt, total public debt that we have out there right now. Now, the system following the great financial crisis got very habituated, many would say addicted, to ZERP, you know, zero or extremely low interest rates. And now we've had this massively aggressive hiking campaign and tightening campaign. Tightening maybe hasn't been as aggressive as the hiking, but the Fed's not done yet. And people like you and me, I think, who respect math and economic history have said, look, there's a lag effect to all this that will definitely be felt, and be felt harder than in periods past because the debt is so much bigger now. But the markets don't seem to care. And a lot of people aren't that worried about it. I think they're kind of adopting a sort of like, well, I mean, it hasn't happened. So, you know, maybe it's just not going to happen. Maybe we're going to have a no landing scenario, right? So should we maybe start there with just sort of the cost of the debt?
Yeah, let's talk about it. So we should know that monetary tightening works with about a year lag, maybe 16 months, about a year lag. But if you go back a year from today, what was the Fed funds rate 1 year from today, like 1 year ago today?
I think it was under 3%.
2.5%. So if it, you know, right now we're at 5.25 to 5.5, but a year ago it was only 2.5%. So we have a long way to go before we start to see the real teeth and the bite from these monetary hikes. We have a lot of wood to chop here before we start lapping, right? At least several months have to go by before we start lapping that 5% and above Fed funds rate. 2.5 is historically nothing. But here's something else I want to touch on. And this is very crucial to what I think you were talking about why the recession is held in abeyance and why the higher cost of money is going to mean something, especially to corporations. Of course, it means a lot to the government too, but we'll get to that later. So what I see is a corporate debt, I call it a maturity wall, going to hit in 2024 and 2025. There's $1.8 trillion worth of corporate debt that needs to be refinanced between now and the end of 2025. And the rates on that debt, Adam, are going to be between 4 and 5.5% higher than they were when they locked it in several years ago.
Yeah, and just to be clear, you don't mean 4.5% increase. You mean you're tacking on an additional 400 to 500 basis points, meaning it's like over a doubling of what they were before.
Yes. So I'm not talking about they're not going to be borrowing at 4.5%. It's going to be 4.5% higher than what they borrowed in 2020 and 2021. Okay? Got it.
And sorry, just to be super clear on this for folks, when you borrow, you tend to borrow from a bank at the prime rate plus something. Right. And the prime rate has basically more than doubled in the time period that Michael's talking about here. So when your old debt that you've been sitting on and happy to pay low interest rates on comes up for maturity, if interest rates stay in the same ballpark they are right now, literally the cost of your debt is going to be at least 2x, probably more than that.
Exactly.